So just to mention whatever we have said so far, a localized wave packet can be formed as a result of superposition of infinite ideal waves varying in their wavelengths. Wave packet, okay, of course, this particular part I have not talked about, which I will try to mention now, that if I want to talk of the speed of the wave packet, because this wave packet is essentially the speed of the envelope, and that we have said that the envelope travels, does not travel with the speed of omega by k, but travels with the speed of d omega by dk. So what you will find out that this wave packet actually will travel with the speed of d omega dk. So in fact, what is most important in the physics is not the group velocity, not the phase velocity, but the group velocity, which is defined as d omega dk. So this is the only realistic velocity for any wave, because as we have said, all real waves are always finite in dimension, they are always wave packet, okay, and they will always travel with the speed of d omega dk, okay. Only if it so happens that omega is equal to constant times k, then group velocity and phase velocity will turn out to be same. But in the case of particle wave, we will see that this does not happen, okay. It will actually be different. Two speeds actually turn out to be different, okay. But in fact, there are many other cases in which you will see that group velocity and phase velocities will not be same. But as I said, the realistic speed is always a group speed. The phase speed is only of mathematical consequence, which if at all there was an infinite wave, that wave would have traveled with that phase speed, which anyway does not exist. So there is no special physical significance of the phase velocity. The position of the wave packet is not completely localized. The wave packet of the wavelength is also not unique. This leads to what we call as uncertainty principle. Now let's look at the implications of the uncertainty. When wave nature and particle nature coexist, we have to allow certain tolerance in the way we look at the nature. So this is what I have mentioned just now, that if both the things have to be together, many type of thing which we are used to talk in terms of classical mechanics with certainty, okay, uncertainty has to find its way. Things we will not be able to talk in that certain manner in which we are used to talking in terms of classical mechanics. We have to allow certain tolerance in the way we look at the nature. It's not exactly the way we thought the nature is, okay. Physical interpretation of the wave we shall discuss later, but at the moment let's look at its implications. So this is a very interesting experiment which we always do, and which we always describe when we are talking about uncertainty principle. It's a very, very beautiful experiment which tells how the way we look at the nature would become different if we are talking of uncertainty principle. So I am pretty sure all of you know about the Young's double slit experiment. It's basically performed with light source. You have two different slits and you allow a monochromatic beam to travel and divide themselves. The wavefront gets divided by these two slits, and then these two things actually get an interference. So once these two waves interfere, you start seeing dark and bright fringes that I am sure all of you know, okay. And because this is because of destructive and constructive interference, because the path difference turns out to be different, and depending on what is the value of the path difference, these two waves can interfere destructively or constructively. You may get a large intensity of light or you may get zero intensity of light. This experiment can be explained on the basis of wave nature of the light that we understand. Now basic thing is that, as I said, this particular experiment can very easily be understood about the wave, from the wave nature, so long we do not invoke the particle picture. Now I want to invoke the particle picture and want to see what type of problems I face into it, and that's what I will associate to the uncertainty principle. That's the reason I have made that statement last time, just now, that uncertainty principle protects wave particle duality. So I am trying to mix up these two ideas on an experiment which can be very well or much better described on the basis of wave theory, okay. So I make a statement and let's accept that we agree with that. At the moment, I am talking of only light. I have also mentioned that light consists of photons. Light also is a dual character. Like particles have a dual character, light also is a dual character. In some experiments, it shows a particle behavior. Some experiments, it shows a wave behavior. And interference is one experiment where it tends to show a wave behavior. So I make a statement that whenever I get a bright fringes, a large number of photons go and hit that particular point. See, remember the intensity is always associated with the number of photons. Its energy is associated with the frequency, okay. If I am saying that a light is more intense, it means it has larger number of photons. If it is light is more energetic, then its frequency is larger, okay. So a place where you have seen a bright fringe, essentially it meant much larger number of photons came and hit at that particular point. If you see a dark fringe, no photon came and hit at that particular point. So I hope you agree with this particular statement that in a photon picture, a bright fringe would mean a larger number of photons hitting that particular point or reaching that particular point, and a dark fringe would mean no photon reaching that particular point. So this is source of light. Let's suppose a monochromatic source of light. You have two slits, S1 and S2. One I have said blue and another I have said red. Now this wavefront gets divided by these two slits, and then there is a constructive interference. And ignore this particular part of the figure at this particular moment. Okay, just look at this particular thing. Of course, intensities of these fringes are not always same, but we have just taken, as I said, pure cartoon. If you go to a point P, this particular point P here, there is a destructive interference, the intensity has become zero. At this particular point, the interference has been a constructive interference, the intensity has become maximum. Here again, there is a destructive interference, the intensity has become zero. So you see destructive, constructive, destructive, constructive, constructive, and you get fringes. These are generally called fringes. Okay. So when I say here, there is a constructive interference, a large number of photons have come and hit this particular point. Here, there is a dark fringe, it means no photon has come and hit this particular point. So this is standard experiment. Now let us perform this experiment with electrons. We know that electrons can be diffracted. Okay. Now, of course, these experiments now can be done, ways in which you can perform these experiments even with electrons. But you know, the length scales that we are talking. But let's just take at this particular moment as a sort of a thought experiment. So let's assume that we have exactly similar type of experiment. See, remember, for electron diffraction, you have to have really slit distances which are of the order of angstrom. Okay. While in the case of normal light, you know, these distances can be much larger. But as I said, let's suppose we are able to perform this experiment using this type of length scales appropriately. So we'll observe exactly similar type of pattern, okay, because we know that electrons can be diffracted exactly like to light, okay, and therefore we would also see, instead of this particular light source which I have given here, if I had a monochromatic or rather mono energetic source of electron, okay, I should be able to form exactly similar type of fringes using electrons. And let us also accept, let us also agree to the fact that when we said that a dark fringe here means no photons, okay, and a large bright fringe means a large number of photons, in the case of electron, it will also mean the same thing. If I am having a dark fringe of electron, it means there is no electron which is reaching here. If I am having a bright fringe of electron, it means a large number of electrons are reaching. So all that I am using, instead of the word photon, I have replaced with the word of electron. Otherwise, everything has to be identical. Of course, length scales have to be different, but let's assume that we are able to perform this experiment with an appropriate length scale. So this is what I said. Similar to photons, a bright fringe would mean larger number of electrons reaching there, and a dark fringe would mean a very few electrons reaching there. Now let us go into some funny questions. See, let us ask the question, how does the electron reach on the screen? The electron goes from here. How does it really reach the screen? These questions are looking very sort of naive questions and very sort of simplistic questions, or sometimes, you know, can say some sort of mad questions, but let's see that they have a lot of meaning. So if we say how the electrons actually reach the screens, so this is probably the question that I am going to answer. They are emitted from source. Some of them move towards wall. Okay, of course, there is a source which can emit electrons in all the directions. Okay, but only some of them actually will move towards the wall. And if they hit a point where there is no slit, they will get absorbed. Some electrons will arrive at a point when there is a slit, and they will cross to the other side and then reach the screen. So there is electron which are coming, some electrons will go and hit here, or some electrons may go in this particular direction, they are of no interest. Some electrons will come and hit this particular point, they will get absorbed, then again of no interest. Then some electrons will come here and they get absorbed here, they are also of no interest. But will some happen that some electrons will come through this slit and then they will go and hit here. There's some electrons which are coming from this, then they will go and hit here. Okay. So all I am trying to say is that the way that these electrons can reach this particular screen is only by going through slit S1 or slit S2. So this is what let me reread this particular slide. They are emitted from source, some of them move towards wall. If they hit a point where there is no slit, they get absorbed. Some electrons happen to arrive at a point where there is a slit, and they cross over to the other side and then reach the screen. My question is that, are we really sure? Okay, let's perform the experiment and try to see. So what I will do, I will close both the slits. If I close both the slits, I will not find any electron reaching on the screen. So obviously, this slit was necessary for the electrons to make them reach the screen. If there was no slit, no electron reaches there. So it's very clear that electron has passed through those slit, then only it has reached. Okay, question looks silly, but let's see, it has a lot of meaning. Close both the slits and we would not see any electrons on the screen. Hence, presence of slit is necessary for the electron to reach the screen. So let's be very clear that this slit was really necessary for the electrons to reach there. Now, again, this is a silly question. Do electrons reaching screen pass through one of the two slits? We just now said that there are two slits, and if we close these two slits, no electron reaches there. So presence of slit is necessary, that's for sure. But does it happen that the electron really goes through one slit or the other slit? That looks very silly. Since electron is really a particle which cannot be split, so is it not obvious that it should pass through one of the slit? How silly is the question? It's almost like asking a question that if we are sitting in this classroom and there are two doors, okay, and I say the person who is sitting in this particular room has either come through this door or through that door. Obviously, a person cannot come through both the doors together. Okay, a person cannot be divided. His head cannot come from one door and leg can come from the other door. I mean, so asking this question is almost as silly as that. An electron is a particle. We always thought that it's a particle. And if it is a particle, it in principle cannot be divided. So half the electron or a head of the electron cannot pass through one door, and the leg of the electron can pass through some other door. I mean, it has to come either from this door or from that particular door. So how silly is the question? Had it been equally silly if we are talking about the interference of two classical waves? Remember, classical waves, if we are talking, probably we will not be wondering about this question. Because remember, wave is an extended property. Wave is an extended thing. Okay. In principle, remember, this wave can simultaneously, in the sense, we have totally different concept. This particular slit is dividing its wavefront, and these wavefronts are sort of interfering. This is not localized. This is not a wave which is only going through this slit or through that slit. But this electron, we know, is a localized entity. So it has to go either through this slit or through this particular slit. So, this particular thing that I am describing would not have been that dramatic if you are talking about photons, because photons, we have always a vague picture. Okay, photons also consist of photons. Particles are also, light is also consisting of photons. But photon, we have always a very funny meaning, sort of jittery feeling about the photons. Oh, after all, photons are waves. Okay, but when we talk of electrons, we get shocked, because we always thought classically that electrons are particles and particles cannot be divided. In that sense, electron is a fundamental particle. How can an electron be divided into two parts? So as we see that it's not a very silly question, as we will soon see. If this statement is true, then if we perform two experiments, one week we'll have only slit, we'll open only one of the slit. Then find out how many electrons are passing through that particular slit. Then we close that particular slit and open the other slit. Okay? Then, or let me put it the other way. See, any electron which is reaching on the screen, in principle now, can be classified, the one which is coming through slit S1 and coming through slit S2. Now, let us try to close them one by one and try to see what is the effect. So, this is what I have written. We can classify the electrons reaching the screen into two parts. Number one, those which came through slit S1 and those which are coming through slit S2. Can we experimentally verify this particular statement? So we perform three experiments. First, keep only slit S1 open. We open only one slit. Choose a point P on the screen. Count the number of electrons N1 reaching that point in a given time. Then keep on changing the position of point P and find N1 as a function of position for the same time. See, we did exactly the same experiment when both the slits were open together. But now I am performing the experiment by opening one slit at each time. Then we look at when both the slits are open. Okay, and then we try to see whether we can really qualify our statement that this particular electron has either gone through slit S1 or has gone through slit S2. Okay, so first we keep slit S1 open, then choose a point P on the screen and then vary its position. Find out the total number of particles which are coming and hitting that particular part of the screen. Repeat the experiment with only slit S2 open. Now, close S1, have S2 open. Then find out what will be N2. Okay, find out the total number of particles which are coming as a function of different position of the point. Okay, at different locations. Let's say in a given time, and find out N2. Then we keep both the slits S1 and S2 open. And then calculate what will be the N1, or rather measure what will be N1, N2. actually I must get n12 is equal to n1 plus n2 if whatever I am saying is correct. If I have to find out the total number of persons sitting in this particular classroom, okay, I first close one of the door, repeat the experiment. Those persons who are coming from door 2 will get blocked there. Okay, only persons coming from one door will come. Okay, I count their number, then open the other door, then let the people come from the other door. If we count the people, okay, we'll always find out that the number has to be matching. So, total number of people who are coming from door number 1, total number of people who are coming from door number 2, they must add up when both the doors are open. That's what is as simple as the question. So, if both the slits S1 and S2 are open, then N12, we must get equal to N1 plus N2. Now, let's try to look at this particular picture, which in the earlier case I have sort of not shown. If only slit S1 is open, which is this one, which I have said marked blue, I am not sure whether you are able to see color very clearly, then what you will find, you will see not really an interference pattern, but what we call is a diffraction pattern, where you see a broad maximum very close to the slit S1. There is some sort of small interference here. I am sure you know a single slit diffraction experiment. This is what you will be seeing here. If only slit S2 is open, then you will see a behavior something like this, which is the red one. Here this particular maximum will be very close to the slit S2, and this will be some sort of a oscillation, some sort of maximum and minimum because of the interference, particles coming from different parts of the slit. This is smaller the slit, this particular second maximum will be pushed larger distance away. But when both S1 and S2 are open, then these two interfere as we know, and what I will get this particular pattern is what we have discussed earlier is will be N1 N2. Now, it's a very, very funny thing. If only one slit was open, I was getting very large number of electrons here. But when both the slits are open, suddenly at that particular point, the number of electrons are coming here have become very, very small. Here, of course, they were large. Here also they were large. But at this particular point, where a very large number of electrons were coming only through, when only one of the slits was open, when second slit got opened, a very few electrons are, essentially no electron is reaching there. As if the electrons reaching, you know, going through slit S2 has realized that now slit S1 is open, so I must have the particles, the particles should not go there. I mean, this makes a ridiculous sense. As if they can talk to each other and say, okay, now this particular particle, this particular thing is open, this particular slit is open, so I must pass through that slit or I must not pass through the slit. They can decide. Okay, normally we do not expect this type of thing. All right. So, when both the slits are open, in fact, you will not find N12 is equal to N1 plus N2. So, what has happened? What has, how things have changed? See, the answer is no, we will not get N12 is equal to N1 plus N2 because now I have interference pattern. With one slit open, one sees a diffraction pattern. There is no interference pattern due to the other slit. There are places in screen where which receive much less number of electrons when both the slits are open than when one slit is open. Can electrostatic interaction change the path when both the slits are open? The fact is that you can perform this experiment extremely slowly when only one electron is coming at one time, but still you will find that there will be an interference pattern. This interference pattern does not depend on the number of particles which are going through this particular thing at a rate. So, I mean, there is no possibility that one particular electron, another particular electron, there is electrostatic repulsion and therefore they have changed their path. Okay, this will not happen. Okay, if you really see, and such experiments have now been, it has been possible to perform now, when you have only one electron going through slit at each time, okay, still you will find when both the slits are open, you will see an interference pattern. Okay, this interference pattern will not be visible if you have only one of the slit open. Okay, obviously electrostatic interaction is not the reason which could have changed the path. Even if electrons are emitted very slowly so that electrons reach one by one, still they would show interference pattern when both the slits are open. So, as I said, do the electrons know that there is another slit open, so they decide to change their path? Okay, human being we consider as intelligent, so they can probably talk to each other that okay, if this slit is not, if the door is not open, can we change our path? Okay, but do we expect the electrons also to do the same thing? That they can talk to each other saying that okay, this particular slit is not open, so let us not go to that side, let us go to some other side. Now, things that this looks somewhat shocking, but as I said, probably we would not have been equally surprised if I had repeated the same experiment with the case of light. Light also consists of photons. I can argue exactly the same thing. Instead of electron, I replace the word photon. Same arguments can be made there also. But when I say photons, whether they go through slit 1 or slit 2, you are not very surprised again. Oh, after all, photons were waves, you know, that's the way we have been always taught. So, you have a very hazy picture in mind. But we get a shock when we talk about electrons, because we always thought electrons are localized particles. And these localized particles have to behave in a different fashion. Okay, they can go only one by one, you know, they can only go, only one particular electron can come from one particular state. It cannot come from the two electrons cannot simultaneously, or one electron cannot simultaneously come from the two states together. What I want to say, our concept of particle is based on our observation of bigger particles. We can see them, we can see these particles, and we never see them diffracted because wavelength is too small. In fact, I mean, as we have said, the wavelengths are of the order of 10 power minus 34 meters for a cricket ball. Now, I mean, obviously, if you have interference pattern, you have to measure fringe widths of the order of 10 power minus 34 meters, which is never possible. Okay? We do not know how the particles appear when they become as small as the fundamental particles. Clearly, we have never seen an electron with our eyes. We do not see these electrons the way we see the bigger particles. A bigger particle we can see very easily. Okay, person is sitting in front of me, cricket ball is in front of me. I don't see electron that way. This is what I have said, mysterious particle. Our impression of smaller particle is based on the extrapolation of our ideas of bigger particles. The way we think that bigger particles are behaving, we expect exactly the smaller particles to be behaving exactly in the same fashion. Obviously, this extrapolation is not correct. We cannot think of small particles exactly the way we see, I will say under quotes, we see bigger particles. These particles do behave mysteriously when they are small. Okay, I think I'll go to this thing in the next class. We have 10 minutes left, so let's go to the questions if you have some questions.
Yes, Bhagwan Parshuram Institute, 1164.
Yes, sir, I want to ask you about the photon and the phenomenon of superposition.
Yeah.
For the photons, okay? Because on behalf of wave nature, we can say when two crust or two top will match, okay? Superimpose, yeah. That is, we will find constructive interference.
Yeah.
Okay, but one crust or one top will superimpose, we will find destructive interference.
Yes.
Okay?
Yeah.
At that instant, the probability of photon and the intensity is zero.
That's correct.
So, there is no any photon at that point.
Yes. Yes, that's, you are right. That's what I am trying to say, that this particular picture of interference having destructive interference is not consistent with the classical concept of particles, where we say that these particular particles must go either from one slit or the other. Because if that happens, then the total number of particles which are coming from one particular screen, when I open the second screen, that number cannot go down. So, whatever you are saying is consistent with the wave picture, but is not consistent with the particle picture. So, that is all I was trying to emphasize, that when I try to mix up the classical picture and the quantum picture together, I will land up into this particular problem. I will not be, because classically I would have expected an electron to follow a particular path, go through either one slit or go through the second slit. Okay, and it goes through that, when I keep the slit one open for a particular duration of time, a certain number of electrons reach at a particular point. If I open the slit two also, that number cannot go down. Okay, that can go down only if we understand interference, and that interference is difficult to understand, or it's not, we cannot understand from the classical picture of the particle, which is a localized concept. That's all I'm trying to say.
So thank you, sir. Slide number 6, please repeat it.
Yeah.
In photon picture, a bright fringe would mean larger number of photon reaching at that point. A dark fringe would mean no photon reaching. But yes, principle of interference is conservation of energy. Okay.
Yeah.
So, on here, there is no any photon in the destructive interference.
No.
Can surely say that there is no any photon at that point?
No. See, the conservation of energy is totally different way of looking into. See, total number of photons which are reaching must reach somewhere. That's what involves conservation of energy. So, at a particular point, there will be a larger number of photons coming, or a particular point, a lesser number of photons will be coming. So, conservation of energy will be taken care of. That's not an issue. The issue is that what we are trying to say at this particular moment, that whenever we are having a larger intensity of photons, that in the picture of photon means, I mean, see, intensity we define in terms of the wave nature. Okay, whenever we say that a light is more intense, essentially it means a larger number of photons. Okay, so if I am seeing a bright fringes, it means a larger number of photons are hitting there. Okay, conservation of energy will always take place, the total number of photons have to be conserved. Okay, they will either get absorbed or then whatever will happen, the total number of photons has to remain, I mean, have to be all accounted for. Okay, so conservation of energy will take care. So, it's not bothering about the conservation of energy. It's only saying that we are trying to mix up two ideas. One is the wave aspect, where we know how to define intensity. Intensity is defined as amplitude square. Then, when we are coming of particle nature, then we say that the intensity depends on the total number. If you look at the explanation of photoelectric effect experiment, Okay, the intensity of the light is given by the number of photons. So similarly, when we are having a bright fringe, a larger number of photons are reaching that point. That's what I'm trying to say.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir.
Welcome.
MES.
I have two questions.
Yes, please go ahead.
First one is, if particle is stationary, its momentum will be zero, then lambda will go infinite. What it means actually, and what happens to boundary conditions?
I mean, see, thing is that, you know, this is a, once we go to the quantum mechanical, actual quantum mechanics course, if the particle is actually bound, in that particular case, the particle cannot be stationary. It will always have a finite energy. The ground state energy cannot be zero. Only when the particle has infinite extent, it means particle is not localized, only then it's possible to have its zero velocity. So that particular problem is taken care of. But let's at this particular moment just accept the fact that if really you have lambda is equal to, I mean, if you have p is equal to zero, which as I said in quantum mechanical case, you will not find to be the case. If it happens to be zero, then in principle, the lambda will be infinite. So we are never doubting at the de Broglie relationship. Okay, we are only talking about the uncertainty in the value of lambda or uncertainty in the value of x. But lambda is equal to h by p is still obeyed. Now, when we come to the quantum mechanics, we will discuss this particular aspect that for any bound system, the ground state energy cannot be zero. So for a particle in a box, you know, the ground state energy has to be a non-zero energy.
Okay, I have a second question.
Yes, please.
When we are talking about wave nature of particle, means particle is represented by waves.
That's right.
Okay, then yes. Is the wave is going to give you information about the position only? What is happening to mass of the particle? Means is mass is having same classical meaning in quantum mechanics?
Okay, well, in the traditional quantum mechanics, you know, because this is supposed to be non-relativistic, mass is exactly the same meaning, it has no other wave. Okay, this will come into the picture like for example, you know, when you're talking of the energy, kinetic energy, etc., all those things, because, you know, as you will see in Schrodinger equation, mass will always appear. So mass of the particle will always be there. In fact, this about this particular mass, we'll talk also quite a bit when we are talking about what we call, when we are coming to the Schrodinger equation. So mass, the concept of mass does not change until, of course, you talk about the relativistic quantum mechanics. Okay, as you know, in relativity, mass, I mean, there's something called rest mass, and this mass could change. But here, the concept of mass is exactly identical as earlier.
Thank you.
Welcome.
Yes, Netaji Subhash.
Sir, particularly I enjoyed the cartoon that you have shown.
Thank you.
Where you have one wave traveling and five cartoon characters actually identifying them.
Yes.
And where you have the interferences mixing up two waves.
Yes.
Where you have localization of a wave packet.
Yes.
Then they could not identify, and some people are identifying it with larger amplitude.
That's right. That's right.
Interesting question is, I mean, I just want to know.
Yes.
Classically, the amplitude square is the energy.
Okay, go ahead. Yes.
I mean, classical picture. Classical
yes.
picture
yeah,
of
yeah.
Wave.
Yes.
Huh? Amplitude square is energy.
Yeah.
So where the person standing, if there is a amplitude and this is the node, sort of node.
Yeah.
Okay. So yeah. They don't find it as there is any wave. And
yes.
Some character, it would be helpful if you can show that particular cartoon page. The person who is actually standing beneath the amplitude
yes.
will observe that a wave is with a larger means energy.
Yes.
But the person who is standing at the particular beneath the node
yes.
he will find that there is no wave at all.
That's right.
If the wave is something like that, I mean, can you elaborate that? I mean, really interesting to know, actually.
So, sir, the thing is that in the classical way, what you are trying to say is perfectly right, because in principle, the energy would depend on that particular amplitude. And you can talk in terms of what is the amplitude that you are talking. I mean, there is a perfectly, there is a harmony in that particular thing. There is no sort of contradiction there in that sense. See, only when we start talking about a quantum picture in that particular thing, that's where we start getting contradiction. So long we are talking of pure wave nature, so long we are talking of pure particle nature, we have no issues. Okay, but whenever we are trying to mix up these two issues or an experiment which can be described by, let's say, wave nature, we want to describe using particle nature, then we'll have problem. Or an experiment which we want to describe basically on particle nature, let's say photoelectric effect experiment, which can be much better described by particle nature, if you want to bring in your wave nature, there you'll have contradiction. So, I mean, the cartoon which I showed was a purely classical cartoon, and whatever you are saying is perfectly right there.
Yeah, thank you, sir. Thank you.
Welcome.
Don Bosco.
Okay, the question is,
yes.
the wavelength, the more the number of wavelengths that you add, the particle gets more localized.
That's right, that's right.
My question is, what role does the amplitude of the wave function, does it play in localizing the same wave function?
Okay. See, thing is that, you know, basically Fourier transform, if I go back to that particular transparency, see, let's look at this particular equation which I was trying to write. See, if you see sine kx minus omega t is basically the sinusoidal form of the term. Ak dk appears to be the amplitude of this particular thing. Okay. Now, A in principle is a function of k. It means depending upon what k you are using, the amplitude can be different. So, Ak can be a function of k of whatever form you want to use it. Probably we will try to add one or two problems which will give you one or two specific forms of Ak, just to tell you that depending upon how Ak varies, this yxt can have different type of dependences. So, essentially this amplitude will determine how yxt is looking like. Yxt is actually the realistic wave packet which we are seeing. So, this wave packet can be thought of infinite, because I am integrating from 0 to infinite all ideal waves which have amplitude Ak dk. Now, depending upon what is A as a function of k, yxt will be different. So, this amplitude plays a role in the actual type of wave packet that I am taking. If Ak happen to be reasonably large and over very large extent, okay, it means it essentially doesn't peak, but you know, goes, or the distribution of k's for which Ak is significantly large is very large, then in that particular case, yxt will be fairly localized. So, this is basically what I am trying to say, that this amplitude will have a role to play in this particular functional form.
Dronacharya College.
So my question is regarding the shortening the wave packet.
Yes, yes.
So, we are using superposition principle to shorten that wave packet. But in the example, we have seen as the number of waves we are increasing.
Yes.
In superposition, the distance between the maximas, it is increasing.
Yes.
Obviously, the distance between minimas is also increased. So, how is it shortening the wave packet?
No, see, the basic thing is that you should understand that, see, so long, if you are mixing a finite number of waves, this particular maximum is going to be displaced by a finite amount of distances. Okay. If I am mixing infinite number of waves, okay, this particular maximum is displaced to infinite distance. It means once it has decayed, it never rises again. Okay, this is a, let's say, qualitative way of putting into it, but there is a mathematical way of putting it, which I have just now shown, that by an equation, you can actually mix an infinite number of waves and find out what is the value of yxt. Okay, once you find out that value of yxt, you will know that this turns out to be actually localized. This is a very, very standard problem in Fourier analysis, as we call it, or Fourier transform, where any finite disturbances can be decomposed into infinite number of ideal waves. So, if one knows about Fourier transform, it's a very, very simple question, but this is the only way of qualitative explaining to the students, because when the first year students come, they do not know about the Fourier transform, and we have to sort of convince them that by mixing a large number of waves, we can really localize it. So, the way we can put it like that so long we are mixing finite number of waves, once there is a maximum, that maximum gets displaced by a finite amount of time, finite amount of distance. Okay? If I mix infinite number of waves, this gets displaced infinite distance away. It means once it has gone down, it never rises again. Alright?
Okay. Thank you, sir.
Welcome. I think we'll just stop now. Thank you. Bye-bye. All the best.